Yeah, that's right.
Okay, welcome everybody to the Monday, June 10th, 2019 Board of Selectmen's meeting. Calling this meeting to order, and we'll start with the
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, approval of the agenda. I have two items under committee and board reports. One would be an RSU 21, and the other one would be a planning board. Does anybody else have anything?
Motion to approve as amended.
Motion by Jason to approve as amended.
Second.
Seconded by Phil. All those in favor? Next item on the agenda is a public forum where we take public comment from non-agenda items. Anybody from the public interested in making some comments?
Kind of, but I don't know if you want to deal with it there or under old business. It's about that intersection.
Limerick Road setback, that's not that, that's down the road, yeah, so, go ahead, Roger.
As you guys know, we had that survey, and the way that intersection is, turned out to be more than 8 to 10 feet. The survey as originally said, it's like 20 feet. They put a nail in the pavement there. I talked to the Labages about the town doing some kind of formal taking of that, and have not heard back from them yet. They were supposed to talk to their attorney, who is Amy, that works out of your office, I guess.
Okay.
So, I haven't heard anymore, but I would think I've got to schedule some kind of an appraisal to look at that if we're so inclined to do that. If not, and that deal is off, we gotta basically back off that intersection, redo that, what has been done over the course of time, bring the curb out to where the actual property is, and rebuild the lawn, I guess. That has been there. Bill could probably attest to this, as long as I can remember, there was something there. And it got improved over the course of time, but it obviously is not the town.
I know that this is not a thing that we'd like to do, but is there, you know, an eminent domain type thing that we could do there?
That's the problem, so.
Well, yeah, but he was talking about, you know, if their lawyers had, you know, like.
The problem with this is it's already a substandard lot in size. So they can't willingly sell you something and create an even smaller lot. So it would have to be some form of taking by the town, as long as it's an agreed upon price by them. If they're not interested, they're not interested. But as long as it's.
Roger, you talked about straightening Limerick Road?
Well.
How much land would she capture on straightening Limerick Road? Would that give her any?
I don't know that they would get anything there. We were talking about teeing Bridgestone into Limerick, and in the course of straightening that little yank out of Limerick Road, that would be across where Ruby's driving is roughly, but I don't believe that road's in the center of the right of way yet, and we'd have to buy any of the property to do that. But budget-wise, you know the paving prices, I did talk to them, and they agreed to drop $2 off per ton. Still not gonna fund this whole intersection.
It helps.
It helps, but again, it's not gonna get that intersection. But at some point, we either gotta decide, yes, in theory, we wanna do this at some point, but we've gotta do something with that piece that we do not own.
Yeah, I understand that property's going up for sale.
I believe it is.
So, yeah, so we might want to do something before then, if we're gonna do something.
I talked to an appraiser, he said his fee is probably gonna be about $1,000 to appraise it. And the way those pieces are, sometimes he says that fee is more than the land is actually worth. I'm not putting any price on it, I don't know that. And I'm not saying that would be the case here, but I don't expect it to be a lot of money.
Well, certainly,
Do you want me to reach out to their attorney to find out what the status is?
Yeah, I mean, we.
And what's your?
We gotta try to figure out a resolution to this.
Yeah, and what's your?
Right, I mean, the cheapest solution would be to leave that intersection as that turn as is and then just straighten out the Lemon Grove. Like, that would be the cheapest.
You still gotta do something that piece of property that is.
Oh, I understand that, right, I understand that, but I would imagine that little piece of property is still a lot cheaper than re-changing that whole configuration there.
So do they own that little jog where you come from the Brimstone Road onto the Limerick, that's around their lawn, they actually own that?
They own three quarters of that.
So they could actually bring rocks out and close that off?
In theory, it's their property.
That's been like that for how long's that house been here? 30, 40, 50 years, 60 years?
I don't have any objections to the strategy about trying to take it by eminent domain, but I think you need to, because, and the only reason I say that is because it's a substandard lot, and you, if they sold it without us trying to force the sale, I think there would be some sort of zoning violation. With us taking it, I don't think the zoning violation would exist, and they could go ahead and sell that property and it would be in compliance, so. But I think Roger's right about maybe trying to figure out a happy medium as to what it would take in order to purchase it. So.
I could talk to Amy.
Tom's agenda.
Do you want her to call, want me to reach out to her first, or?
No, I'll talk to her tomorrow.
Alright.
Ask her to contact her client and contact us.
Okay, they were supposedly gonna talk to her about this, and I haven't heard back from them at all, and she said who her attorney was, and I said, oh, okay.
I'll check in tomorrow.
Okay. Good, anything else? Moving on, approval of the May 28th, 2019 minutes.
I'm gonna approve as submitted.
I'll second that.
Motion by Tom, seconded by Velma to approve as submitted. Any other discussion? All those in favor?
I'll say. I wasn't here, I don't know.
You never know, it's me when you're here.
Yeah.
Alright, committee and board reports. Talk a little bit about the RSU 21 meeting, June 3rd. Excuse me. They had nomination of Karen Moore, part-time 1B Spanish teacher at KHS for 1 year. Nomination of Elizabeth Hellerin, school social worker at KHS, and then they added an executive, a second executive session. They had two executive sessions at the last meeting. Katie did a presentation on the enrollment task force, and what they're looking at is recommendations for balancing and stabilizing the enrollment in the RSU 21. They came up with five different recommendations, and this was for the first reading. They haven't enacted this yet. But they've got five different recommendations, and they have a sixth recommendation. If what they're doing is, as they're watching it year to year, that sixth recommendation will come into play. And what that does, it has three approaches. They'll have to decide on which approach. But all of those approaches change the catchment areas. So that means that somebody from Arundel may end up going to a different school, or the other way around. The thing about that, though, is that once they do, and that would be from kindergarten on, once they do, they won't be split up. So they won't be like at third grade, all of a sudden half of the kids will go to one school and the other half will go. They'll stay together, but they'll just go into, it'll be either third or fourth grade, they'll go to another school where other kids will come in. So they may not necessarily be in the same class, but they will all be together. So they're kind of looking at that. That was a very, very long discussion. So there's more to come on that. There was also a presentation on the athletic field capital campaign. The high school field, you know, it gets used an awful lot, and there's really never a season where there is no use. And that field just gets, you know, it gets beat up so bad, and it just never gets the opportunity to regen. So they're looking at a whole bunch of improvements. They're talking anywhere right now from $2.9 to $3 million for that. But they're doing a campaign, a capital campaign, to raise funds, not to go to the taxpayers for that. So they get the okay from the board to go ahead and pursue that and kind of get that going.
What are they going to do with $3 million?
So, which put a new track, change, they're actually thinking of putting like an artificial turf in there, bleachers, you know, a whole bunch of different things like that. So, consent agenda items, the nomination of Stacy Knapp, she's an instructional strategist at MSK, nomination of Madeline Kasprzak, science and math teacher at MSK, nomination of Elizabeth Holloman, school social worker at KHS, nomination of Jane Matheson, full-time power school scheduler and test coordinator at KHS for 1 year, nomination of Karen Moore, part-time Spanish teacher, KHS for 1 year. I already had said that one. And resignation of Nathan Hall, teacher of language arts at MSK. Human Resources talked about their meeting with the ed techs for their contract. They had two meetings. Everything went very well, and they will bring everything to the board at the next meeting. We went into executive session at 9:16 p.m., and I didn't hang around for the two executive sessions, so I'm not sure what time they got out of that. So that's that. Planning board. So the planning board had a public hearing on three items. Item to amend the land use ordinance, 6.1 urban residential. Item two was adoption of commercial animal husbandry farms. And item three was amendments to the contractor yards, land use tables, and performance standards in the land use section. The big contention on this again was a commercial animal husbandry item. Tom, were you involved with that when, because the comp plan and the planning board worked with that, you were involved with that one, right?
Yeah.
So the big issue was $15,000. And I had some discussions with Jamie after the meeting a couple days later, and the concern from the general public is somebody would have to show that they're making more than $15,000 to become a commercial. And that really only comes into play if somebody has got an animal husbandry and they say, you're a commercial entity, not a residential entity. Then at that point, they would have to show and prove. If somebody wants to walk up to the town and say, I want to do a commercial animal husbandry, well, there's no need to show that amount. They just follow the land use ordinance and follow all of the issues that go along with that. I have a feeling that at town meeting this is going to come into, there's going to be a lot of discussion. When we start, we'll talk to Durwood, but when we start the town meeting, I would like to change to do Article 4 first and then go back to Article 3, because Article 3 adds animal husbandry to the list, and if commercial animal husbandry, and if that passes, Article 4 doesn't pass, then you've got that in there with nothing. That's a suggestion that I'm making, and you might want to look at it and see if that's a good thing to do. There's a whole bunch of items that also get added on Article 3, but I think we should talk about that. If Article 4 fails, a little conundrum here.
Do you want to
Do you wanna get the chairman of the planning board involved in it too, with your some discussion, or do you think as read that's, as you suggested, is the way, the really way to do it, in your view, as you looked at it?
Yeah. Yeah, my only concern was Article Three has a whole bunch of other stuff that they're doing, and I, you know, I don't know, maybe I talked to the chairman to see what the ramifications are of all of those, because they might have been working with some of these things, and actually I have it listed here also. Take a quick peek here. Yeah, so they remove a lot of stuff. I don't know what that's gonna do. I don't know if commercial animal husbandry farm is there, and yet we have nothing for it. If, you know, what's the worst of the, what's the better of the two evils? Because if this one passes, or this one doesn't pass, and there are a lot of things that they've crossed off that would not be. Do you have the exhibit there, Tom?
No, I don't.
And then the other thing is, so there's legal action being taken on a planning board decision. There was comments from the public that why would we be trying to put in a land use ordinance changes if there's legal action? Does that affect? And I didn't think it would have any issue with that. I think we're okay to continue on with that.
I agree.
But
I agree, that doesn't affect whatever action the planning board has already taken. If the ordinance changes, right, then it goes from that date forward, right, not what happened in the past.
Yeah, yeah.
And any decisions or any appeals would be based on the old ordinance during the appeal process.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm not quite understanding your concern. Article 4 just deals with the definition of animal, commercial,
yep,
animal husbandry.
Yeah, so
and that's a conditional use in the R1,
so
as proposed.
Yeah, so if Article 4 passes, then commercial animal husbandry doesn't exist. Right, that's new.
If it doesn't pass.
Correct.
Yes.
It doesn't exist.
Right, but you can't, you're not going to be able to amend Article 3.
No, I don't want to do that. I wanted to vote on Article 4 first.
Well, what if it doesn't pass?
Then Article 3 has to, you can't pass, or we have to say that if you pass Article 3, then you're passing something that we just failed.
Well, it just lists it as a conditional use.
Yeah.
Which doesn't have a definition.
Yeah. So
you're just going to work on getting a definition for it, but you can still pass it.
So I mean, are we okay if we have something there that doesn't have a definition?
I wouldn't be wildly concerned about that, because I think it is the ordinance right now, there are a number of things that don't have definitions.
Yeah.
Mm. But I mean, it just happens.
Okay. I didn't want to be in a situation where we're opening ourselves up to, because we pass something that doesn't have a definition, and what happens if somebody now wants to come in and says, hey, I want a commercial animal husbandry because it's listed in your land use ordinance, mm-hmm, and we get no regulations on it.
Well, not that we don't have regulations, it just doesn't have a definition. So I can't look into decide whether I am or not based upon, because there's nothing telling me whether I am or not. But there are others. Does the other sections deal with? Yeah, we just might have to live with the inconsistency if that's the way it goes.
Yeah.
Until we can remedy either with the definition some everybody can agree to, which is going to be a tough nut to crack.
Okay. We'll stick with that then. So anyways, you know, the planning board voted to send all those to the selectmen for warrant, which we already approved. We adjourn at 8:45.
Which they have said they're not going to do anymore. As soon as the changes are made and they vote to send them to the selectmen and have all the public hearings. Because what they would really like in the town report book is the fact that underneath one of those changes that it would say planning board recommends and selectmen recommends or whatever. And of course this was done in, I'm not going in such a hurry, but it was done to get it in the book that that's not on there at all, on any of them. And they would like to see that. So.
Yeah, we'll talk.
Have we ever done it in the past? I don't think we've ever made recommendations on the land use ordinance.
Never have.
No, and that really came from one individual. That came from a public individual, went in the public, it was part of our joint meeting.
I see.
Yeah. And we'll talk a little bit more about our joint meeting, like that on the agenda. So that's all I have for committee and board reports. Okay. Moving to manager report.
Yes, just to sort of give you some updates of where we are in some of these things. I think we talked about it before everybody got here, but the subcommittee for the building committee will meet again on the 18th of June, and then on the 25th there'll be a full-blown building meeting with the full committee to go over whatever details have been flushed out by the subcommittee and put on paper. I do have some design paperwork already that was just sent to me, and I can share it with you all and the rest of the committee at that point, or I can email it all to everybody so they can take a look at it. But part of that process was to meet with Naoto at the solar center to discuss solar panels and the ability to utilize that as primary energy uses for the building. In our discussion, Naoto suggested that that the solar panels not be placed on the roof. Felt that that was the most inefficient way of doing it, and suggested that in lieu of that, we have a removable array of 18 panels that would be placed. From what I understand, this thing is computer generated and will rotate with the sun to get the most efficiency from the system. He indicated 18 based on some estimates I gave him on existing energy uses now. He can detail that up a little bit better once he sees some better plans. But his thought was the movable array was the best way to go. He got into questions, you know, if there's a 35 mile an hour above wind, the things go horizontal. So the wind goes through. If there's a driving snowstorm, they go vertical, so the snow will fall off them, and then they go, then they reset at some time in the future to continue to get panel. Again, he reiterated to me that he's in for the cost of this of 50% of it, and he was throwing around some pretty large numbers as to what it was going to cost to put the solar array in. So. Once we get more details, I'm sure he can narrow down what the cost actually would be. Intrigued, he seems really excited about it, and we'll see where it takes us.
If you want to see some of those, he has two or three out behind
his shop. Right, he's got three that are set there now. In fact, the one in the all the way to the rear is the type and the size that would be set.
We need 18 of those?
Yes. 18 panels.
Oh, panels!
On the array.
I was just going to say.
So there's only one single array.
Yeah.
And if you want to see an array in action, it's over at the elementary middle school, right? Yeah, the middle school, over on Thompson.
Thompson Road.
Yeah,
Thompson Road. Yeah.
Right. They have one out front that rotates.
Was there any discussion? Remember, Lita talked about some transfer of energy credits to somebody else that he had?
We talked a little bit about that. We hadn't got into it quite a bit in our discussion with him. It was more about looking at what it was going to be and what he thought it would be. And that was about it at that point. I wanted to let you guys know the status of the arrow. Obviously, if you didn't get it in the mail, it's out. I took out most of it just with dollar warrant articles and some explanations there. So hopefully it helps folks get a better understanding of what's going on. The other thing I have is that I had a resident of the Pines Mobile Home Park complain to me via email about the substandard water quality that they were receiving within the park. Not knowing who to contact, because it's been very very obscure as to who really owned it, who was in charge of it, I reached out to the DEP, who handles water quality issues, and they must have talked directly to the people who operate it, which is operate the water system, which is Water Quality and Compliance Services, and Chuck Appleby. He got back to me today indicating what they're trying to do with the system. Evidently, they're having an abundance of people that live within the park that want to violate the rules in terms of washing their cars, power washing their properties, and this well system that they have isn't equipped for that type of system. So based on that, they're working with the folks to try to solve the issue. He reached out and sent an updated letter to the person who complained to me if they weren't aware of what steps the owners of the property were trying to do to satisfy the problem. So I think that the parties that are responsible for this are sort of working on it. So I think that's where we are at this point. The other thing, I think I sent you an email reference to this. Greg 70 has left our employment as one of our contract deputies. Greg has taken a position in Acton Shapley as a contract deputy there. And the primary reason is, 10 miles or so from home with a newborn and that kind of thing. It just works out for him. You want that down?
That's all right, John.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. And as a result of that, we were searching for one. We have found a deputy. We'll have him come in and meet with you. So the new deputy will start immediately. His name is Martin Harmon. Martin was his first part of the career was a dispatcher for the Sanford Regional Communications Center. Then he went to work as a police officer hired by the town of Elliott, and he worked for them for a bit, and now he's come to the Sheriff's Department, and they've assigned him to be our contract deputy. So Chris Woodcock has gone to Gaze at this point, and Martin will take over the evening shifts ASAP. I've just sent the Sheriff to bring him in at one of our business meetings so we can put a name to a face when the time comes.
As far as budget goes, we're within our numbers.
Martin will be less than Greg was, yeah. So we're within our budget framework. Yeah. And that's all I had.
Okay. Old business, Limerick Road setback.
Yeah, I just wanted to give you guys a, Mr. Labonte was in front of you looking for that, some sort of consent decree. You suggested that he go to the ZBA. As I understand, he has gone there, filled out the paperwork. Sometime in June, middle of June, they'll be meeting with him, and hopefully they'll get some sort of resolution for him at that particular point. So, took your suggestion, is moving on.
New business, Pine Tree Waste, cast elimination.
Yes, I was contacted by the Pine Tree Waste folks. They had an event that occurred with their employees, which we suspected they would at some point, evidently. This gentleman was a Workwell employee that they had, and given the responsibility, indicated to them that he was, that he had his license. They gave him some responsibility to handle cash. He had $850 of cash on him. They went, and then he got in an accident and found out he didn't have a license. So I think they've been reviewing that the cash is sort of getting to pull him out. One of the things we asked them to try to do was to put in a swipe card system of some sort so people could pay by card. They've indicated to me that the cost was very prohibitive at this point to do that. So they've made a suggestion they'd like to do away with cash at the transfer station and only deal with punch cards and or checks that would be written out. I indicated to them that I wanted to talk to you folks, and that's why I asked Roger to come too, because I found some things off Roger as well. I made a proposal to them to consider another alternative, which would be to eliminate charging for recycling and create a system, because I was looking at it that you got 7 cents a pound, you got 12 cents a pound. So really, how are you going to manage the punch card system? How is that whole system going to work? It's a little confusing to me as to how that would work effectively. So my thought was, and we've had a lot of pushback on charging for recycling. So my thought was, we eliminated the recycling and provided a per pound amount on the trash that would handle the volume of recycling that they get as well, and do it on the trash amount, that we may be able to be in a better system where there's one punch card, people can, I'm thinking that we're going to have to start charging or paying or submitting those, or being able to have people collect their cards at the town hall again. So we can sort of have a little bit better control, and then the cards would be there, and then folks can either write by a check or a card. So they haven't got back to me about that. They wanted to give it some thought. The issue I have is that they want to start this pretty early. They want to start it in the month of July.
And we're not going to go through this again.
Yeah, I think that's a little too early as to what, because they just got to me on what they wanted to do there. So I think maybe we can push them off, but have further discussions with them how this all is going to coordinate. Because I'm sort of up in the air. I don't go there every Saturday. I don't see what's going on. Obviously, they feel that they've got some issues with losing of cash, so they're trying to remedy that. But
so what you suggest if they eliminate charging for recycling? You suggesting that you increase a little bit on the trash, okay?
To make up the difference, charge a little bit more for trash, allow people to recycle. We have stickers now, so residents only, so people that have stickers will be able to come in. So you're controlling the recyclables that I think we've got in abundance before when we didn't have the stickers. So maybe we get a little bit better with that.
Have you noticed that gotten better since we did the stickers? It was cardboard that was the issue, right?
Cardboard was the issue because Kenny Monk was charging a pretty good amount, like $55 a yard. So if somebody shows up with a card, pick up a load of cardboard, it was $55 and Kenny Monk. They brought it to a rumble.
Yeah.
For nothing.
Wouldn't it make sense if the system was going to change to start charging by the bag rather than by the pound? Because the delays that are caused up there when people are lugging bags out of the back of their vehicles, putting them on the scales, then the guy's got to add up 3 bags of 10 pounds. You know, if you just did it by the bag, somebody walks in, they got 4 bags. In fact, you could charge ahead of time for the bags. So instead of buying a card, you buy a bundle of 50 bags. Then when you get up there, bingo, it's gone, it's quick, there's no transaction time.
But I have a trash compactor, and I'll tell you what, my bag is a heck of a lot heavier than a regular bag. When I fill up a trash barrel, it's heavy. You know, I put three or four bags in that, it's heavy because I got a trash compactor.
Well, what happens now is they have bags in the town of Wells where I reside, and they are so thin that you can't back them like that. So when you actually, if you pack them like that and went to pick them up, they rip in the hand. So they're sort of tempered to the size. They're very flimsy.
You end up covering your original bag with the bag you buy.
And down there, it was, they charged me for a 33-gallon bag, five bags is $10.50. So, and I don't know how...
Speed up the process, but it will also create a lot of problems, because every place that went to a paper bag, you got to buy special bags and stuff. People just bite that tooth and nail.
But you're going to get a lot of pushback into the town hall to buy a card or bags or anything like that, because people can't get there.
Right. Well, we would sell, because someone would sell the cards at the station.
Or a check.
Transfer station.
Not cash. Or
yeah,
a check.
Not a check. And then we obviously could take cash at the town hall for any cards that folks in order to make sure that we, pass that through our accounting system and to Casella for whatever we collect. But the biggest pushback I've got is recycling. People are just upset that they got paid for it. You know, if we can do away with that recycling piece, that may be it. And then we got one charge, one card, and then we have to set up that punch card in a way that, people don't feel that they're being taken advantage of. Because what I hear now is that somebody will have a punch card, and somebody will come in with a bag. The bag may only be 3 or 4 pounds at 12 cents a pound, and they get charged $1.80. And then that's not right. And I've told residents that come in that that's not the way the contract's written. They're supposed to charge you by the pound, they're supposed to weigh it, and charge you that way accordingly. So, whether or not, so the punch card would have to be set up in such a way that we have increments on
the gradients would have, not the gradient.
Right.
But
it's 20 cents a pound. And then I would say that every punch would have to be 20 cents and set it up in accordingly. Yeah. So.
You're going to get pushback from the residents that don't bring recyclables. They're going to say, geez, I'm paying for everybody else that's bringing in recyclables because the price is going to go up for them.
Yeah.
Which it's...
But if you're not bringing recyclables, then you're not recycling. So, I guess you pay for what you're getting rid of, right?
Yep, we have two buckets. One's recyclables, one's trash.
So, I'm going to... I've laid that out to them as an alternative, and I haven't heard back, but I'm going to reach out to them and say we're not interested in starting July 1.
No, we want to make sure that we,
whatever we do, it's got to be
6 months in advance.
We got to hammer it. I mentioned that in my report.
Yeah.
We want to make sure that we talk about it, that we,
okay.
That they give them plenty of notice and say,
if Casella representatives want to come and talk about it, I can coordinate that. We can bring them here and they can chat a little bit more about it as well.
Yep.
And that may be a good thing because they have more insight in the market and how this all plays out than we do.
No matter what you do, if this is an ongoing thing with recycling and the way it's changing because of the market.
Yeah.
What they're selling, they're not able to sell, and pretty soon...
People think that because it's a recycle, it's free. Well, that's just not the case anymore.
Right.
It costs money to handle all that stuff.
And I'm not sure, they want to change, and they want it quickly, but I'm not so sure that they don't have the authority to do that.
You sign a contract with them.
The contract that doesn't specify that. So we'd have to have a modification to the contract that we all agreed to, and July 1 is just not going to be it. Okay. That's what I thought you guys would say, so I wanted to make sure I passed it by you.
Okay. Next item is the planning board, the board of selectmen and planning board workshop. A couple of items with that. So we had our meeting, and I think it went okay. One of the suggestions that I mentioned to the planning board was that the end of March, I use the end of March, but we can go beginning of March, but for any land use ordinance that's going on the warrant, that would be the cutoff date. There would be no more public hearing for any land use ordinance. That was one item that we kind of talked a little bit about. That gives them time for if there's discussions and they have to have another planning, another, you know, public hearing, it gives them enough time to be able to at least get it to the warrant in the right way rather than trying to rush it the last minute.
Were they receptive to that?
They were. And they did mention the fact of that they're going to be doing, anytime there's a land use ordinance provision, they're going to do the public hearing pretty much when they're done. They're not going to wait till spring and do a whole bunch of, you know, so as they work it, they'll have their, and I think that's, you know, that's a good thing. They suggested that we ought to look to see if there's a way that we could have an admin for TAD. I know that's a budget item. There's concerns that the town planner doesn't have enough time to do everything that needs to be done. You can probably gauge that more than we can. But there's talks about putting together an agenda items and, you know, and making copies and doing all of that stuff for the.
Well, let me give you my ideas on that whole thing. Because I think I realized that the upstairs office, the assessor, code, and planning could use some sort of supportive staff up there. And I think that's a reality. But my whole purpose of avoiding to do it now was to wait until we had the new building. Because then you're going to have a separate first floor, separate location, separate counter that people will have to come to do their business. And my thought was at that point that we would look at putting some support staff in that location to help those three folks get through their business. So it wasn't something that I haven't thought about.
Okay.
So I've given it a thought. And I think, again, we'll have to discuss it during the budget process to see if it warrants further funding and further discussion. But that was my thought, and that was my plan moving forward. I've sort of expressed that to some of the staff in the office as well as them upstairs. So
yeah. Okay, good. Let's see what else was there a discussion. It was a suggestion to hire legal to review ordinance changes. Not sure if we would go that far, but that was a suggestion. The other thing that was brought up was they asked that general public comes to the Board of Selectmen with an issue, that we attend their meetings and bring it up at their public comment. Kind of say, look, this is kind of what we've heard. You know, talk about some of that stuff. And they also talked about the third party ad hoc committee. So
would that be to review the ordinances and try to put them in a better system?
What it would be is to do that, but then come to the planning board and ask as a recommendation. A recommendation would be, okay, yeah, we'll have a committee to put this pamphlet together, or, you know what, we should do a repeal and replace, or you know, just to kind of review everything and kind of, am I getting that right?
Yeah.
Right? That's,
yeah.
And that's kind of what.
Get rid of some duplications and errors and omissions. I mean, where you have something in one place, it shouldn't be there, it should be someplace else, but do almost a whole review of the ordinance.
And who makes that up? The ad hoc committee?
It would, who would make it.
Who, what would, who would be on the committee?
So it would be planning board members, member of the general public, maybe selectmen, somebody from the select board.
Comprehensive plan committee.
Yeah, comprehensive plan. That was kind of, you know, and I think, you know, Dawn of the Kindred had kind of put something together, a book that looked really nice, that has some warrant. And, you know, I think we need to look forward at that, to look to see if that's worth. And maybe that's, you know, something that we, yeah, what she had put together was just kind of a little pamphlet, a little cheat sheet that kind of listed if you're in this,
She did it over the R1 district.
Yeah. You know, this is where you find all the information, this, you know.
Do that for each district.
Yeah.
So that if someone went to Ted and they were proposing something in that district, you've got your sheet, your checkoff sheet, you've got your pamphlet, and they're on their way.
With a huge disclaimer.
Yeah, yeah, really, yeah, 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 you have to. Yeah.
And, or that we hire an outside firm to go through the ordinance cover to cover and again find those errors and omissions and duplications and.
Well, Southern Maine Regional Planning will do that for you. They'll review your ordinances and provide you recommendations. I spoke with Paul, because I remember we were talking about this earlier.
Yeah.
I talked to Paul Schumacher about perhaps do you offer that? And he says, yes, we're doing it with a number of communities now. That's something you want us to look at.
Yeah.
So,
and maybe that's something the planning board can work with them on. You know, I mean, to hire somebody, I think that would be a very expensive.
I think that's just crazy.
What does Southern Maine Regional, what do they charge?
Well, I don't know.
Oh.
I can find out, though. Yeah. You know, they're in the business for dealing with ordinances all the time. They may have a, you know, a little bit better way to maneuver through this and work with the planning board and create something, but
I used to work with them all the time.
Yep.
We pay for some of their services.
Yes,
right?
We do. We pay dues to them about $1,600 to $1,800 a year.
Yep.
So they can provide us some services, but we'll have to pay for some of it as well. But yeah, if you hired an attorney or oh my God, you know.
I'll tell you, but I don't know anybody who wouldn't want to do it. I'd be scared to death if you screw it up.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you're never going to get involved. It's impossible.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
It's impossible.
Couldn't pay me enough to do it.
So does anybody else that attended the meeting have any other comments? Did I miss some stuff, or is there anything you want to add to that? Or?
No, I think that to me that was the big thing is hiring of someone, or again Southern Maine Regional Planning, to go through the ordinance, because it seems that every time we make an addition, that addition maybe should go here, here, and here, and it doesn't end up doing that. So it's kind of a mishmash of stuff.
Well, one of the suggestions I made to the planner and the planning board chairman was that they need to take, this is only me, you know, making suggestions, but they need to take those off Thursdays that they don't work, they're not meeting, and sit down and start banging some of this stuff out. Maybe clearing it up and cleaning it up. That may be an alternative as well. And then maybe getting some expert help to sort of get the ball rolling, and then maybe the planning board can pick that up and try to do it. That, you know, a couple hours every other Thursday, I think is unreasonable to ask them to. And they're the ones, I mean, that put it together, so obviously maybe they have some suggestions as well.
I made the comment that it shouldn't be Tad making the ordinance revisions and then presenting it. Right, Tad should have, you know, you can make the revisions, but the board, along with Tad sitting here, needs to go over and go through it and dig into the ordinance and look at the ordinance and, you know, try to, rather than what happened the last time. And again, I think a lot of this it was a perfect storm. We were trying to get a whole bunch done at the last minute, and when that happens, you make mistakes. You try to wash, you dry, and you know, you get walk-ins that come in, and you know, it just.
Well, we know how long it takes because you folks took on that street design changes, and it took us months to get through that piece of the ordinance, and that wasn't a big piece. It's not something that's going to be done overnight, that's for sure.
And I'll reach out to John because John was at the meeting. Any comments that you can share and?
No, I think you guys have covered everything that that happened there. I can't remember anything else that's worthy of mention.
Yeah, good.
We agreed that we were going to try to meet on some type of semi-annual or
yes,
or something like that.
Yeah. Have a kind of a workshop meeting.
Very good.
I would say at least twice a year.
In a short time.
Good. Okay. The next item on the agenda is videotaping of I meant regular meetings. You put down a wrong.
Oh, I thought it was the end of town meeting.
No.
My apologies.
Yeah, it's okay. So there was members of the public that they made comments that, you know, they half the time they can't hear things, they can't, you know, sometimes the planning board will, you know, Tad will, you know, just barely talk, and somebody over here will, whatever, you know, and they can't hear that. So that's why I was looking at that thing today to see if there was an input for a mic to try to get better sound quality. I know that with the new town hall, the new municipal building, that's going to be a discussion. But I think we ought to start looking now to see what's available. You know, like the school, this thing is wired, and it's all set up to do live stream. Everything's here. We just don't own the equipment. Right? RSU 21 owns the equipment, and I think we need to kind of look at that and see what's available and maybe start getting some of that going. Or in a short term, you know, we find a camera that we can put a mic on, and a better mic or something to that effect, so that people can hear. I kind of wanted to throw that out.
Right. Okay. I know that I met with the interior designer and the architect, and in the main building, in the main meeting room, there'll be a table, for lack of a better word, a selectman's table. That it'll be at least 9 seats wide, so we can accommodate the planning board. And each location will have a mic on it that will be hooked into whatever system that we decide to put in. So I think we're going to eliminate that. And quite frankly, purposely, I've sort of stayed away from purchasing the large ticket items because didn't want to spend the money on that when we were, in essence, we're going to solve that problem. I understand the frustration that maybe folks do have in not hearing what's going on, but it's been like that. I don't know how long you've had that camera now. So,
for a while.
Yeah, okay.
The microphones are pretty inexpensive. I mean, you can buy like a couple of mics that tie in together on the selectman's table. But because you've got to have something on camera that you can plug into. This definitely doesn't have any.
No. So I'm going to do a little bit of research. I mean, I have a spare GoPro that you might be able to do something. You know, you could add a mic to it. So I'll do a little bit of research. I'm willing to, you know, let the town use my spare GoPro and you know, I'll have to add a battery pack to it. But I've got them, so.
I'll volunteer to sit here with the GoPro on my head.
What happens when you start going like this?
Damn, boys, damn. But, you know, the GoPro you can put right on a tripod. You know, it's set up for a tripod, and we can do something.
Yeah, if we can do something that isn't costing us a lot of money, I just think it would not be wise to spend it all now.
Yeah. And the thing with the GoPro is it has an input. Can buy a mic relatively cheap, and there are different types of mics that you can buy that will focus in, and so, you know, we can kind of look at that, and let me do a little bit of research and see what we can do, at least that piece, until we get the new town, municipal building.
Okay.
Okay, that's all I have. Other business? Has anybody got anything else to new business? No, we didn't have. Other business, approval of payable and payroll.
Just the payable.
Just payable.
Yep.
So moved.
Motion by Velma, seconded by Jason for the payable. All those in favor? Okay. Anybody got anything else they wanna bring up?
See y'all on Wednesday night.
Make sure you go vote tomorrow.
Tomorrow's voting.
One thing I do want to at least throw out there, I think we gotta think about doing an amendment to the charter relative to competitive bidding.
Okay.
Because this is silly, you know, having to go up to competitive bids to get people to help us with competitive bids. So I, not right now, I mean, we got too much stuff going on, but I think we should get a review committee together again and look at that and maybe find some exceptions.
Okay.
To that provision.
Okay.
Yeah, that, some, you know, I mean, something that we could use right now, really.
Right.
Hearing nothing else, looking for a motion to adjourn. Motion by Jason at 7:57, seconded by. All those in favor? Meeting adjourned, 7:57. Thank you all for coming.
Oh, sorry, you couldn't get the guy to find the guy, so Steve, you'll put work on that guy.
I don't think I have a lot of pull, but I go, maybe. Misconception.